straight into the concerto. And in a way, the program is ordered in such a way that it made perfect sense to do that. In the second half of the program, as you can see, we've got Dvorak's greatest symphony, the seventh. Not the most popular symphony, but actually, symphonically, probably his best work. And then we're starting a complete cycle of George Lloyd symphonies. As many of you remember, we played through the complete symphonies of Malcolm Arnold, which was an astonishing journey for the orchestra and for our audience, giving people the opportunity to hear these symphonies in a live performance, which is such a different experience from just sticking on a CD player or whatever your choosing format is and listening at home. There's a concentration about live performance, the use of your eyes, that makes it a very different experience. And also the programming of pieces with different pieces somehow throws a different light on them. So we're starting off on George Lloyd's symphonies. I don't know how often the first symphony has been played. Premiered a long, long time ago, 1932, in Penzance. Performances initially, Bournemouth Municipal Orchestra, eventually becomes the Bournemouth Symphony Orchestra. Quite a lot of interesting performances at the beginning of his career, really prestigious. And then comes the Second World War. And the Second World War completely changes everything for George Lloyd, as well as for everybody else. As I've said before, I find it astonishing that somebody who joins the Marines and works on the Arctic convoys to Russia and suffers incredible hardships is then treated with such disdain by the British musical establishment after the Second World War. I think it's an absolute disgrace, and I will continue to say it until the day I die, whatever the BBC say to me. So therefore I am very passionate about presenting these symphonies to you, because they deserve to be heard. You make your own minds up whether you like this piece, whether you think it's a good piece. What really happened with the piece is that when George was recording in Albany, late in his life, in this astonishing sort of Indian summer when he's American orchestra in Albany, who had this marvellous concert hall on top of a bank, the Troy Savings Bank, recorded a lot of his music with George conducting, and when it came to, and they commissioned the 12th symphony from him, and he decided to look back at the first symphony, with the form that he used for it, and decided at the same time as writing the 12th symphony to look back at the first symphony and revise it. So if you buy the CD, you get the first and the last symphonies on it. And what is interesting is the use of form and the astonishing creativity of somebody at the age of 19. This is a 19-year-old symphony. And I think it's quite astonishing. It's about 24 minutes long. And it's structured it's in one movement. It's effectively in three parts that interlink, like an ABA structure, where the middle section is a short, slow movement. But you hear the theme for the slow movement very early on. It's quite a loud, lively opening to get your attention. And then you hear this, and that's the theme of the slow movement, and the theme that appears at various points throughout it. There are other little themes. And I think one of the things that we found in the rehearsal process is that there's a humour in this music. I wonder, it's sort of like, I have no experience of 1920s, 1930s was like, but I suspect there's a touch, dare I say it, of saucy seaside postcards about it. Remember, this is a composer who's growing up in Cornwall, and a lot of his early performances are taking place in Penzance, and there's just the way you listen, the way the woodwind, in particular the brass, the trombones, the trumpets, keep on sort of cheeky-chappy commenting on what's going on in the orchestra. And it's interesting also what he does with the orchestration. It's immediately got the fingerprints of George Lloyd. Another interesting factor to look out for is the fugal section, which starts the last part. It's quite complicated. It's typical George Lloyd because it's got an infectious rhythmic lilt to it. And I think that's what a lot of people in the musical establishment don't like. It's actually very attractive music. You find yourself tapping your feet, and you're not allowed to tap your feet to Radio 3. Okay, so it's banned. Okay, I love Radio 3, and it's a great presenter. Petrock's a huge fan of George Lloyd, so. But anyway, this is the first symphony of George Lloyd. As I said, it's about 24 minutes long. Those of you here for the first time, when we get to the interval, make your way through there. There's drinks through there for your
Thank you.